Hello,
Hi.
Everyone.
Hello.
Welcome to the podcast.
Oh,
this week brought to you by Braintree, Sherry's Berries, Squarespace, and My Horse Voice. I'm going to talk for an hour and a half, and you're going to enjoy listening to my shitty voice.
I'll tell you what I'm enjoying.
What?
I just raided your office.
Those are my snacks.
Because this is December, so this is the time of year when like all the businesses send other businesses like gift baskets and stuff. But you're the one who deals with so many vendors because of RTX. I don't deal with really anybody.
Yeah.
So you get all the treats now. So I just raided your office and
it's,
I have all,
it's
all
funny
the treats.
That that there was a huge box waiting for me when I got to my desk this morning, and
brag about it.
I opened it up and there was that giant gift basket in there. Huge gift basket, tons of gifts. I'm very important. And Barbara and Bethany are like, "Oh, who sent that to you?" And I was hesitant to tell Barbara and Bethany which vendor it was because I don't want them honing in on my gift basket.
Yeah.
I was like,
"Good call.
It's a vendor for RTX." Like, which one? I was like, "They do some printing for us." Like, what do they print? Like, badges. They got it out of me.
So you're sick from flying?
I'm sick from a lot of stuff, I think.
You've been flying a lot, though.
I've been flying. Yeah, I got so I was in Sydney doing prep for RTX Australia. Then on the way back, I connected in San Francisco, so I stopped for PSX for the weekend. Then I came home, and then I immediately started shitting for about 24 hours straight.
Wow.
Alternating with sleeping, and I've been a mess.
Wow, you took an international flight and a return flight in a week? That sounds fucking brutal.
Do you ever think about...
It's amazing, isn't it?
It's amazing how brutal that must be.
Do you ever think when you take a dump after a long international flight that you're dumping... You're dumping, like, another country's food into your country?
You know,
I actually have thought about that. I'm upset that I thought about something that Gavin thought about.
I think about it because when you're going into Australia, they're so crazy about no outside flora and fauna. Yeah. Like, no outside
food. I got plenty.
Food. Yeah, it's like, I'm filled with it. You can't stop that. I'm going to dump all in you.
It is a good point. I mean, that's how... I'm sorry, I'm still chewing cookies here. That's how, on an evolutionary basis, that's how plants spread across the globe. Is something would eat it and then wander off and poop it out with fertilizer and seeds later. And that's how stuff moved from place to place.
Well, and the wind.
Well, that and the wind. But poop, the poop thing is relevant to our particular discussion.
Is that why they call it breaking wind? It's like the same kind of thing.
There you go.
Yeah. Like
so you're coming, if you just go, they don't tell you, don't bring any apples, produce, and also your food's. Your first poop in our country, don't do it outdoors. Like, you think that would be something they would tell you not to do?
Or they give you a Ziploc bag and be like, here, before you leave the airport, we need to see a dump in this bag.
You're joking. That's probably going to happen eventually, right? You're going to have to take, like, mandated poos as you land in a new country. Immigration,
I'm actually
poo,
surprised they
luggage.
Don't do it in New Zealand yet, because New Zealand is the most careful about it. Is Hawaii that
Hawaii,
careful?
They have the conveyor belt thing where they scan everything, and they make you do it, like, two or three times. Even after you go through it first and you get to your gate, it's like, we know you're at your gate, you have to do it again. Are they going to install those in the toilets at some point?
The new Gavin's like weighing a toilet too.
Yeah, they'll have like those beagles with that little vest like sitting there by the toilet being like, smell your butt.
I pissed off I just got back from doing the Amazing Race. So I was gone for like a full month because regardless of how long you're participating in it, they keep everyone away the same amount of time, so you can't tell like what place people finished in and things like that. But I was dealing with like I am very careful around TSA people, but there's a big grind associated with the race, so I got kind of worn down. I pissed off I'm not sure if I can say how, but I pissed off like a security person, and it's the second security person I've ever pissed off. Do you remember the first time?
The first time you pissed
like
off
they legitimately got upset
person.
With me.
I don't remember that.
It was in New Zealand, and they were coming around with a service dog. And the service dog had a little patch on it that was like produce and stuff like that. It was food, clearly a food logo. And I asked the lady, I go, what kind of service dog is this? I go, what's the patch for? And she goes, oh, this is New Zealand. This is a dog. It doesn't sniff for drugs. It was going sniffing in everyone's luggage. It sniffs for food. It finds food, especially a trained dog. And I go, isn't a dog that finds food just a dog? And she got really upset with me. It's like, I always wondered, what's the training for that dog that it's like you have to, you're like, what do you, how do you reward it when it finds food? You give it the food? It's just like all my dogs can find my food my whole life. It's like I gotta keep them from getting my food.
Maybe you have to give them like the same version of food. Like if he finds a pizza, like, fuck, gotta get the dog a pizza now. Like the dog finds broccoli, like, all right, here you go.
What is the best job in the dog world?
Money.
Like other dogs, is that's gotta be top of the list. for a lot of dogs. It's like, what do you do? It's like, oh, I just find food at the airport. It's like, you can pay for that? Find food in my house all the time for free.
They don't get to eat the food.
Do you know that?
No.
Maybe. I mean, I'm sure they get specially...
It would be the worst job in that case. Because well, every like other canaries. Dog that finds food...
They eat it.
You eat it. It falls off the table or whatever, and that's what a dog is for. A dog is basically the vacuum cleaner of the house for lazy people.
Or the dad is as well.
That's the food, hopefully, that hasn't fallen to the floor yet. Although I have eaten that food, too.
The pecking order in a house is that
still
the
on
kids
table.
Get it, dad gets it, the trash... And then if it falls on the floor, the dogs
That's
get it.
Right.
That's basically the way it works.
It's like a Roomba, but you don't have to recharge it.
I remember when we went to New Zealand that time, and I guess it wasn't the same incident with the dog, because there was the dogs, the sniffing dogs, and
Matt
it looked
Holm,
like they were
by the way.
Hey,
Matt
hey, how are you guys doing? I thought it looked like it was a drug sniffing dog, and they were
right.
around those. Do you remember there was like a group of like. Rastafarian looking like, but they were like white kids, but they had like dreadlocks, and they just looked like the prototypical. We've been smoking pot on the beach all day, and the dogs just like didn't do anything, but like the dog played it cool, just came and like sidled up to them, and we're just like hanging out. Like we know, it doesn't even matter. We don't smell anything. We know
it's cool.
We're cool. One time I saw the same thing in New Zealand. Those damn dogs. This guy. You know, they do it when you're getting your luggage off of the belt. This guy gets his bag off. Dog's walking by. Dog smells his luggage and sits down. So you know, the agent's like, sir, we need to go through your bag. The dog has sat down and indicated he smells something in your luggage. The guy's like, all right, whatever. Opens up the bag. The agent like pulls everything out, look through it. There's nothing in it. He's like, all right, sorry, sir. Guess the dog indicated falsely. It walks away. The guy's like, great. So the guy starts putting all his stuff back into the bag, zips it up. Right as he zips it up, a different dog comes by, smells it, and sits down. And the agent's like, sir, we need to go through your bag. Oh. The guy's like, but
I remember that guy
just went through it. And like, the dog sat down. We need to go through your bag again, sir.
Good Lord.
Wow.
So, I like how subtle it is. Like, they don't bark. They just sit. Can you teach a dog to wink?
That'd be pretty cool. Yeah.
It just like shoots a paw at you.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
This guy.
I got this guy over here. Do you see there was that aborted takeoff of the A350 this
no,
week?
An aborted takeoff. That's...
So I guess it was the first A350 taken off from the U.S. It was like a press event where they had like influencers on the plane. They only had 36 people on the plane.
Media influencers.
And they were all in business and first class. It's A350 taken off from New York, flying to Doha, Qatar. It was on Qatar Airlines. And the plane's taking off down the runway. And there's film. I mean, there's video of it because the guys inside were all media people. And so there's this video of this guy filming it. He's like looking at the camera. There's a cameraman in the tail, like looking at the plane. He's like looking out the window, looking at the camera. Then all of a sudden, everybody in the frame just like leans forward. And I guess they say that the plane detected the runway was too short for takeoff, so it automatically applied the brakes.
The plane detected that, wow.
And then, so they had to go back to the gate. People wanted to be let off the plane. They would not let anybody off the plane.
Whoa.
They held them there for 2 hours.
Oh,
then decided they would try to take off on a different runway.
This is a press event?
It's a press event.
That worked out
and
well.
So as the plane's braking and they're stopping, the guy's like looking around with his camera. One of the flight attendants is yelling, turn your camera off, sir. Turn your camera off. Like,
I kind of want that feature out. I want the pilot to be able to know whether the runway is too short.
Right.
I don't think the plane should be telling anyone that.
I hate the idea that a pilot is flying the plane and the plane like says, no, we're going to do something different.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, is the pilot aware? I guess he has some kind of alarm that goes off that tells the pilot, shit.
When you hear stuff like that, and we see these Google self-driving cars around here all the time, where there's a garage on our lot where there's all these the self-driving cars come out of, I always think, are those cars actually impressive? Because, like, isn't all this stuff already in planes and everywhere else? I mean, they've had, like, autopilot on planes and, like, landing autopilot even for the longest time.
You never
time.
Have, like, a homeless guy stumbling across the clouds or anything like that.
I guess
that's
a good point.
Extra technology.
Although, what a magical homeless guy that would be. There's always the magical homeless guy in, like, the movie who, like, changes your life. You know, he touches you on the shoulder.
He goes from a cloud.
Right.
He came from a cloud.
Yeah. I think
runways are also very standardized. Normal roads are not. Like my car has autopilot features. Like my
car, but
it knows.
I mean, that this thing knows that the runway is too short.
But there must be something at the end of the runway that indicates that, right?
Stop.
Yeah, just
fly up or stop.
Also, it's
those are your choices.
If the plane can figure that out, when does it figure it out?
Yeah.
It's like, yeah. Was it like, go to take off? And it's like, okay. It's like the plane is like, we'll give this a shot. I think I can do it. And then the plane was like, no.
It accelerated for 18 seconds. They were up to 100 miles an hour.
No, they weren't.
Well, it must have been
18 seconds. How'd they have time to stop?
Then it says that it applied full brakes and they stopped in 15 seconds.
Wow.
They do reverse thrust as well.
I don't know.
But you need headwind to take off, right?
I do, yeah.
So I guess they can't judge it by just distance. It's like, oh, well, we're at this speed and there's this much wind and it's just not going to happen. So brake. I assume that's a combination of stuff.
So then when you're saying the wind just dropped. So the environmental conditions changed and suddenly the runway became too short.
Yeah, well, that's the variable, isn't it?
No,
the runway is of a standard size, but the wind
didn't. That's when it finally saw the end. It was like, no, I'm not feeling this. I got a bad feeling.
How can a plane measure wind, though, when it's going? Like, how does it measure wind?
Maybe is the speed different than its ground speed? Like, if it's going 150 miles an hour, but then the wind is... No, I don't know. I started saying that.
Just relay it from the little spinny cup thing that they have over on the side of the runway. It might do it from that. Or the flag's like, dude, chill. It's not windy enough.
It winks at you. It's like...
There's certain things that's like you only see certain places. Like the cone-shaped flag that's actually like a cylinder that indicates wind. I've never seen those anywhere but an airport. Like,
and even is that more efficient and more accurate than
a
flappy piece of fabric?
That's what makes me wonder. It's like, isn't a flag just a flag? You look at it and go, okay, it's kind of windy. It's like, and wind is pretty relative. It's like, the flag was flapping less earlier, so it's more windy now. Like, I never actually care how windy it is. It's just like, how windy is it as opposed to how windy it's been? That's all I ever care about. Like, they always get all excited when they put the weathermen are just, like, so fucking bored, and a storm comes through a front, and they just freak the fuck out. They're like, there are gusts up to 40 miles an hour. It's like, okay.
It's one of those things where it's like, oh, wait, that doesn't mean anything to me. Like, it's wind. Like, what does that mean for me?
It means nothing to
me. How much to blow me up in the air is what I'm worried about.
That's exactly what I want to know. Like, they should do that. Like, they do that with other things. Like, they talk about how fast, like, how vicious animals are, like, basically how fast they can skeletonize a cow. Like, a piranha can skeletonize a cow in like 3 minutes. That should be the wind. It's
a
like
tornado.
Here's what it can lift. Picnic table. That's how fast the wind is right now. It's picnic
so that's
table.
What the weatherman should say.
Yeah.
Or like, guys, on Thursday it's picnic table, but on Friday it's car.
They just have different symbols, like the sun and the cloud and the rain cloud. It's like the picnic table, the car, Gavin's face.
Because they make a big deal about it on the weather predictions. They're like, there's going to be gusts up to 40 miles an hour. And you're like, oh, shit. And then you realize if you were in that, you'd be like, here comes a 40-mile-an-hour gust. Oh, it's kind of windy. Okay, that's good. There goes my hat. You know, no big deal.
I discovered that if there was a lot of strong wind, like blowing horizontally, humans would get blown away, but cats wouldn't.
Why not?
Because they could just grip so hard. A cat, when it doesn't want to move and it's like all of the claws are in the carpet, it's not going anywhere.
Cats and little kids. Little kids, when they don't want to get picked up, they're pretty impressive.
Well, they just go dead weight, though.
They either go, like, floppy, or they do, like, that, like, dead, like, they make themselves heavier somehow with that dead weight.
They become more dense.
Yeah.
Who got their glasses blown off their face? Was it you,
That
Matt?
Was me, right?
That was Seattle.
I'm pretty sure that was me, yeah. And that was where there was that stop sign, too, that went.
Yeah.
It bent 90 degrees.
Yeah.
That was
Lord.
We were at Bungie or Valve or something.
Yeah, we were in Bellevue for some reason.
We might have been going to a Child's Play dinner.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, we might have been doing that.
Yeah, that's right. I want to say we stepped out across the street, and I just turned the wrong way, and the wind caught my glasses, and they went, whee!
It was glasses like, wind.
We never saw them again.
Yeah.
See, the weatherman had said...
Yeah, they were gone.
If the weatherman had said that morning, and you heard the news report saying, guys, today's glasses wind, you'd be like, oh, shit.
I would have been like, wait, like eyeglasses, or like if I'm holding a drink?
Yeah.
You know.
But you would have known to be careful either way.
I would, yeah. Not taking my beverage out
there. As opposed to like 50-mile-an-hour gusts.
So I agree with that. I think we should standardize on symbols for wind speed.
Yeah.
What do you think Gus's top speed is? Like, what's a
running speed?
What's a Gus gust? Like, what's my, the top point?
Get a gust
my
gust?
Top speed is probably like 5 miles an hour.
You can do way faster than that.
Nah, I don't know.
I showed Gavin a clip the other day of a guy on a treadmill running 25 miles an hour.
I've seen that.
It's pretty nuts. Yeah. The guy's legs are just a blur.
It was wind assisted.
It's like he has to start up his legs like a lawnmower because he's like practicing with one leg. He's like, and then he just goes like crazy.
Yeah, he also doesn't build up to it. He like just like he stands next to a treadmill that's 25 miles an hour. Then he like hits his foot on it a couple times to get it going and then like just jumps on.
Well, that's building up to it though.
But it's not like he ramped his speed up.
I don't think that's building up to it.
His other leg was still standing firmly still.
Oh, so like you're saying it was a constant speed on the treadmill.
Right.
Yeah, building up to me would be turn the treadmill on and then you run up to it. That's it right there. I think he's an NFL athlete.
Is that, and that's all he's got. Like, he doesn't go for very long.
Yeah, he doesn't go very long. Jeez. That's a burst of speed.
Like a cheetah.
What's your top speed?
Man, I don't know. When we were in training to go in the Amazing Race, I got to the point where I could run, like 2 laps on the track. Like, it's 800 meters essentially, mm-hmm. and I could do that at like 11 or 12 miles an hour, like a full sprint. Which I train doing lots of sprints.
Mm-hmm.
Ashley's a better distance runner, but it's like I got no patience for distance running. I have no patience for it at all. Mm-hmm. And I could run. Even like participating in the race, I could run so much further and so much faster by the end of my time with the race than I could at the beginning. It was crazy. Mm-hmm. It's like cardio is one of those things that builds up super, super fast. Super fast. Mm-hmm. Also, my approach to calories completely changed because I was like trying to trim down weight and all this stuff. And then when I was doing it, it was just like, what do you have that is the most amount of calories to eat for the least amount of money? And just like eat like everything and anything I can get my hands on.
Was it lots of sodas?
What's that?
Lots of soda?
Yeah, lots of soda and Gatorade, which I never do. In fact, I'm trying to break my habits now from the race and mm-hmm. like go back
with
to like eating like a regular person.
Not getting on a plane every hour.
It's pretty nuts. I should probably talk. You want to talk about that for a second?
Sure. So, I'm not going to ask too many questions just because I don't want to bait you into something you can't say.
Yeah, yeah. And see, that's the thing. So the first thing is that the show comes out February 12th. And the big part of that is I can't really say anything. So I probably won't talk about it a lot until right before the show starts, because the last thing you want to do is talk about something you can't talk about. But there's obviously lots of big secrets surrounding it, like performance and where people went and stuff like that. So, but it was a blast. It was the adventure of a lifetime. Like, it was grueling and very, very hard and a lot of fun. And I would do it again in a heartbeat, you know? And it was just like, it's really crazy. Taking international flights like back to back to back to back, you just like, it's amazing how much it wears you down. It's just crazy. And they actually talked to, the whole thing came about, they did a special season, CBS did a special season of The Amazing Race, which is what they call social media influencers or social media stars is what they're saying. But it's just people from all over like Tyler Oakley's in it, big YouTuber, and his teammate Corey, who I had never met before, is like one of the funniest guys on the planet. Just like super easygoing. There's guys, Brody and Kurt, that do like frisbee trick shot stuff. There's some Vine people in it as well. One of the guys is Zach King, he's probably the person I knew the best beforehand.
Yeah, like, I bet if people don't recognize his name, they definitely recognize his videos. I'm sure they've seen him.
You'd recognize him in a heartbeat. Mm-hmm. He does like Vine visual effects videos, which essentially it looks like Vine magic. It's mm-hmm. the way a lot of people describe him. Then there's a guy, Cole, who has like, I think he's got like 8 million followers on Vine. And then Blair, she does like fashion stuff. And then there's just people who do like lots of random stuff. There's some people who have channels that have run for years and years, like Tyler. And then there's some people who had just had like one big viral hit. One of the ladies in it, named Marty, she's the Southwest flight attendant who did the really funny announcement and got like 65 million views on her video or something like that. So, and they just ran a promo for it. We've been, you know, talking about and everything. And it's like, and I just got back. So it's like, Ashley, when we got back, you know, she slept for, I think, 26 hours straight.
Damn.
That's crazy. Yeah, like she fell into a coma pretty much. So, but it was awesome. It was awesome. And the whole thing came about, I kind of derailed myself there talking about the people on it, but it came about because they were doing the social media thing. And it was actually way back at VidCon. I don't know if you guys remember, but there was this Hollywood Reporter article that came out that was like the top 25 stars, and they put me in it.
Is that where you took the selfie with Joe the Cat?
That's exactly right. That's the one. So like the next day after that article, because that article was published, the Hollywood Reporter, I'm assuming, did that article at that time because VidCon was that week, and I was one of the keynotes for VidCon. And like the day after that article came out, the CBS casting called me and said they were doing it and all that stuff. And they actually met with me and Gavin because we were the only people from Rooster Teeth at VidCon. But Gavin has a UK passport, so he couldn't even like...
Got to be American.
Yeah. You have to be a resident living in the US, and you have to have a US passport. Because you could get an unfair advantage like going to some custom lines in some countries. Like if you went to, I don't know, what's a UK surviving colony at this point?
Well, I mean, I have a European passport, so any European country, I'd be straight in.
There you go. I wonder if you get a special line if you went to, say, like India, like, or Hong Kong.
Well, because it used to be British?
Yeah, because it used to be British.
I don't know.
Or what about like Australia and New Zealand? Aren't they still technically part of the Commonwealth?
Yeah, so is Canada too.
Gavin, answer this for us.
I have no idea.
This is where
we went through the same lines in Australia, you and I.
Oh, that's right. Okay. So, anyway, so it was, like it was
because,
a blast.
Because you can't talk about it, it's almost like you're not back yet. I'm excited for it to be on so I can actually talk to you about it.
I know.
I'm excited.
I know.
They've got a fucked up passport control in the Sydney airport that they can fix with just some signs. When you get off the plane and you you walk to passport control, it's machines now, right? Like you scan your passport, then it gives you a ticket, then you walk up to another machine and it takes a picture of your face and it lets you into the country. But when you get off the plane and you go up to the stations, there's two of them. So everyone gets in queue for those two, not realizing there's 12 more right next to them. So it's like everyone gets in line for these two and then you're like, there's 12, why isn't, oh, everyone's just stupid. And you just like walk over and just like immediately get into the country. It's like they just need some signs that are like, hey, is this line long? Look to your right just a little bit. Problem solved.
Having traveled internationally now with no phone and no Google whatsoever, I cannot sympathize more with the statement of just put up some fucking signs. Yeah. Just for the love of God, put up some fucking signs because it would help so much. Or have a fucking map in something that actually makes sense, like where you can find stuff. It's crazy. I mean, there's some parts of the world where it's just like, you know, and if you're somewhere where they speak English, it's great. If you're somewhere where they're not, that's just like you turn into like a mime, you know?
Did you learn any languages in preparation?
I learned a little bit of Hindi, and Ashley focused on a little bit of Mandarin. But she speaks some Spanish, and I speak some French, which there's a lot more parts of the world where people speak Spanish than speak French. But anyway, so it was...
Is that true?
I think so.
There's loads of French in Africa and Canada and stuff.
There's a little bit of French in Canada. I mean, it's like there's a one particular province where there's a lot of French. But yeah, besides Canada and France...
You can get by through most of South America with Spanish, except for Brazil.
Fair play.
Some parts of the Caribbean, too. There's some French as well. But, I mean, Spanish is like, I mean, there's entire continents where a lot of people speak Spanish.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, I think if you had Spanish, and you could limp along in Portuguese, I think. Right?
there's enough words to cross over for it to be confusing.
But yeah, it's like
I watched a word or two through.
When we went on vacation earlier, I watched Ashley limp along with her Spanish in Italy. That was okay. Mm-hmm. She has no problems talking to Italians. They're very attentive when Ashley talks to them. Not so much when I talk to them.
They suddenly understand English when Ashley talks.
I'm going to read this thing here. I want to remind everyone, this episode of the podcast is brought to you by Braintree. Developers around the world have embraced the Braintree V.0 SDK as the easiest way to add secure mobile payments to their apps and websites. No matter what payment type, Braintree accepts it. Apple Pay, Android Pay, PayPal, Venmo, credit cards, even Bitcoin. And if something new pops up, Braintree will support that too. It's the same payment solution used by Uber, Airbnb, and GitHub, so you know that it scales. Developers, we got you. Don't worry about taking days to integrate your payments with Braintree. It's done in minutes. The Braintree code supports Android, iOS, and JavaScript clients. Integrating it into your app is as easy as inserting a few lines of code. Try out the sandbox and see for yourself at braintreepayments.com/roosterteeth. That's braintreepayments.com/roosterteeth. Or check it out. So thanks to Braintree for supporting the podcast. You have good taste in podcasts, Braintree. I think you're going to go places. So when I was traveling, when I was going down to Australia, I had probably the worst possible timing for something to happen to me on that trip. So the trip down there was, the flight was Austin to San Francisco, layover, then San Francisco to Sydney. So when I was flying from Austin to San Francisco, I was, you know, watching a movie on the plane, and I was wearing my headphones. I thought, man, these have been really good headphones. I've had these for 11 years. They've gone with me on every international trip I've ever taken with Rooster Teeth.
They're the Bose ones? They're my Bose. Noise-canceling ones?
Yeah, noise-canceling ones. I was like, really happy I bought these. I can't believe they've been with me all these trips. Get to San Francisco, get off the plane, lay over, get back onto the second flight for San Francisco to Sydney. They close the door. They're like, all right, turn off your electronics. All right. I was like, okay, cool. I'm going to put my headphones on, start listening to some music, maybe fall asleep while the plane takes off. Get my headphones out, go to put them on my head, and as I do this to put them on my head, the earbud on the right just snaps right off.
Oh, no!
I was like, literally just closed the door. I've got a 15-hour flight in front of me, and I just fucking broke my headphones. I stared at them like, it was one of those moments where I just couldn't believe what was happening.
That's
horrible. Like, in my head, I was like, no, they're fine. They just, like, popped off.
It's a bad dream.
When we went to Australia the first time, and Webb
Did you, no, before he gets too far away, did you use those shitty airline headphones for the rest of the trip then?
Yes.
That's those are like 60% volume of what they need to be.
Yeah, it's like you turn it up to 100% and you're like, what? Okay, kind of.
I know. It's literally you have to watch everything like this. Yeah.
So we went down the airways on a, like, how long is that flight? Like 16 hours?
Something like that, yeah.
Right? And on the way down, we weren't sure what we were going to do with Webb because he's only like a year and a half or two or something. And it was that age when they're kind of crazy and they're running around.
I was on the flight with you.
Yeah, but they had like this amazing entertainment system on the Qantas flights. Mm-hmm. They had like not just movies and kids shows, all that stuff. They had like a little video game system in there and everything. So he was happy as could be, you know, because he's playing all that stuff. And it was like, this is great. And then on the way back, we were thinking like, this is going to be great. We had a great time on the way here and it was all broken. Like, none of that stuff worked. Like, nothing worked.
Where my seat didn't work.
Oh, only yours?
Yeah.
This was the entire plane. That's pretty funny, though. Like, they planned it. But this was the entire plane. Nothing worked. And so their solution was to pass out magazines to everybody. And they were like, well, our son's two. And there's like, he doesn't want Ladies' Home Journal. You know?
Yeah, he's not going to bust out his Sudoku.
I don't think he's going to play that for 17
I was on that flight with you. And by the time I was at the very back of the plane, by the time they got to me, I had two options for magazines. It was either Australian gossip magazines about Australian celebrities I'd never heard of.
Yeah.
Or soccer.
What's she done with the dingo?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was like, oh, I'll take soccer. It was like I had soccer. 15 hours with this magazine.
The other like weird media thing from those trips to Australia that was actually kind of cool was like on one of those flights, we were just like really out of it. And like I think we had been up doing a bunch of stuff before we got on the flight, and then of course with the time change and flying for so long, you kind of get loopy. And I was just watching a bunch of movies, and at the end I was watching Inception, and I was kind of like halfway between being awake and asleep, and then I realized like we're on the flight that is in Inception.
Oh,
do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like, it's that same flight,
right?
And when it was done, I was like, I'm really weirded now. Inception myself with Inception?
Yeah.
Did you start looking around at the passengers? Did I dream about any of these people?
I did. I was like, we reached over to Anna and I was like touching her. Like, are you real? And she's like, what the hell's the matter with
you? Do you have a top?
Yeah. Gus, let me ask you a question. Because they all basically get the same planes, all the airlines, right? There's like, how many kinds of planes are there? Major airline. Two. Like
big planes? I don't know. I'd say like seven maybe.
Yeah. There's not many, right? Is the airline in charge of the configuration of the plane?
Yes.
They are.
They can request custom build outs. So that's why there's different seat configurations and different amounts of rows.
Or like bathrooms in like weird places.
Well, the bathroom configuration. So like typically, like let's say the 777, which I just flew on to Sydney. That I think, so there's different sub variants. So you have like, it launched with the Dash 100 series. Oh, no, I take it back. It launched with the Dash 200 series, Dash 300, Dash 400. There's ER versions for extended range. And then within each of those versions, there's sub-versions, typically two or three, that vary galley and bathroom placement.
I feel like we just stumbled into a wealth of knowledge that Gus has. It's like, I had no idea. It's like, you just went into savant mode.
It's part of liking the air disaster stuff.
Yeah. You know all the planes?
Knowing all the planes.
Well,
I love that about you.
Yeah.
Class.
I was on a plane where the bathrooms were downstairs. Like, there was no bathrooms. It was a normal plane, it felt like, but all the bathrooms were on a lower level, and it was like an area where you just went where all the bathrooms were.
Like an entire flight, or just like a couple
of steps? Was it like an open hole and you could see the sky out?
No, there's some similar experiences to that, too. But it was just like a lower deck, and it was like eight bathrooms there.
I've never heard of that.
I've never seen it before either.
What airline was that? Can you say?
Yeah, I don't know if I could say or not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's.
Do you find that you get a little bit loopy on planes? Like, I find that movies are sadder on a plane.
I think that's true. I see grown men crying on planes all the time.
I was,
and I walk by, and it's like Pixar, of course. But yeah. I do see that a lot.
Like, Inside Out is currently in the rotation, and that was like people would be bawling watching Inside Out.
Yeah.
Flights.
I've never cried at a movie, but I came close.
You've never cried in a movie?
No, I came close.
Remember, he thinks
twice.
It's pictures. Or it's light, so it's stupid to cry for light.
Oh, yeah, right? It's not real. I almost cried at a Zac Efron movie.
Oh, wow.
The one with Matthew Perry. And then I was
watching... You cried because you watched it?
No, yeah. It's just like, or man, it's really...
Because of the content.
And then I was watching Titanic, and I was like...
I like that you also threw out there the one with Matthew Perry, is that doesn't help me in any way whatsoever.
But I was like, I was getting really bummed out and sad. I was like, it must be like the altitude that's messing with me.
Were you drunk? Had you been drinking on the plane?
I've never been drunk on a plane.
One thing that happens to me on planes is like whenever I get off a flight, doesn't matter how long it is, it could be domestic 2 hours, it could be one of these flights to Australia that's 15 hours. The whole day, the whole next day, I'm like completely dry. Like I just have to drink as much as I can. Like my nasal passages are just dry and it's just, I don't know what that is. Like I've learned now to basically just like take Carmex and put it up my nose before I get on a plane now, just because it's so I don't like dry out like a raisin.
Yeah, what I'll do is before I get on a plane, I'll typically at the airport, I'll buy a bottle of water and then just drink it on that flight. And then when you go on the long flights and they give you additional water, it's like I just spend the whole time just trying to drink as much water as possible.
You know what's really good about that? Ashley, she carries a bottle of water with her everywhere, like one of those refillable bottles. Mm-hmm. And she just like, she drinks constantly. I never did that in my life. I just one of those people that's like, I would get like one of those 1 liter smart water bottles and just like I can down it in like 15 seconds and that's it. That's how I drink water. I don't like sit around sipping it all day.
Like some prima donna.
I gotta get done. I can't sit around sipping water.
I watched that new Mission Impossible movie, Rogue Nation. I finally saw it on this flight.
What'd you think?
It was really good.
It's good.
It was way better than Ghost Protocol.
You and I are both gonna be up on all of our movies now because we've been on international.
It's American James Bond now, is what it is.
I think it's different than
it's got like a funny edge to it though. It's like kind of goofy in a way too, especially like this everything that goes on between Simon Pegg and Tom Cruise.
I hated the voice that the villain used in Ghost Protocol. I'm sorry, in Rogue Nation.
Dude, okay, that guy is the tough guy version of the villain from Jupiter Ascending. Have you seen that?
Oh, the
yet?
Guy that was like, no. Oh, you bastard.
Have you seen Rogue Nation yet?
Yeah.
The dude looks like it's like the a guy rogue, like he looks little, like a rogue accountant.
The like little mouse guy.
Yeah. He really does. He's got like glasses and he's just like, I'll kill everyone in the room. You know that? But the dude in Jupiter Ascending is like he's breathless. Like literally you just like take a fucking breath. Have you seen it yet?
Yeah.
God.
That's one a movie I saw on a plane.
Yeah,
that's a definitely plane movie.
And I always feel like I cannot judge a movie on a plane.
Did you cry?
I might have a little bit.
A little weep.
No, but really, I like you watch like a movie on a plane, and it's like, I think I'm bored, but maybe it's just because I'm on this plane for so long.
Yeah. Is it so the
movie?
Bad, like,
is it me? Is it it's not like watching a movie anywhere else.
It's true, and
it's
actually
really weird.
I appreciate them so much though, to the point where I travel quite a lot. So now a movie will come out, and I'll see a trailer for it. Say it's a comedy, maybe not very big budget. It's like I'm saving that for a plane.
Yeah,
I'm absolutely gonna watch. Yeah, I'm not gonna go and see that because I don't need to see it big. I'm gonna save it for a plane, and I save up all these movies. I'm like,
because you have to go to the UK a lot.
I'm worried I don't like the movie because I saw it on the plane. I think I'd like this more if I saw it in a theater. If I saw it on, at home or whatever.
There are some movies that I associate
negatively affecting my view of.
There's movies I associate as being plane movies, and now there's certain stars that I only watch their movies on a plane. It feels like, and Tom Cruise is probably one of them.
Mm.
And it's like some movies, it's like, okay, I wanted to see this, but I didn't make time to do it or whatever. And then you binge watch on a plane because, you travel back and forth in certain periods of time.
Yeah.
And you just see the rotation of films.
Yeah.
And what's your favorite movie you've ever seen on a plane? Like you discovered on a plane because you had to watch it, basically.
Favorite movie I've ever seen on a plane because I had to watch. Oh, it was Searching for Sugar Man.
Oh, yeah.
The documentary. I saw that a couple of years ago.
Mine was Edge of Tomorrow. Live, Die, Repeat.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah, because I totally missed that when it came out in theaters, and then I watched it. That's like, that might be the best sci-fi movie in like the last 5 or 7 years.
It's pretty good.
Yeah.
I watched the whole of The Jinx on a plane from beginning to end in one go.
Did you really?
It was class, yeah.
See, I don't ever watch, did you watch on your laptop or something?
No, it's just on the in-flight system.
Every now and then I'll be like,
BA.
I'll be like looking through it and say, like, you can watch movies, you can watch TV. As you hit TV, and you go to watch, there's Game of Thrones, but it's one episode of Game of Thrones. And you're just like, well, that's not going to, I'm going to be sitting here. It's like a random selection.
On this last flight, they had all of season one of True Detective. And I was like, oh, yeah, True Detective. I really like it. I'm going to watch that. So I started rewatching it. And then the episode one, first scene is like that naked murder victim tied up to a tree. And I'm like, oh, right. Other people can see this. Like I said,
I had the same thing. Like I watched something recently on a plane. And I can't remember what it was now. But it was something I didn't know anything about, and I just clicked it, and the first scene was like wall-to-wall tits and just like crazy violent. It was Laser Team. but it was like I felt really like suddenly very embarrassed to be watching this, and thinking like, are other people like watching by and like judging me for?
I feel like you can always apply the rule if it's on the back of the seat, then it's fine. If it's on your laptop, then it's questionable.
This was in flight. This was in flight.
So you they provided it. Yeah. So it's on them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I like that. I like that rule.
Okay. That's, I'll go with that. That works.
They thought about it and they cleared it. Like when I watched.
Is it weird I played it for my kids, though? That's weird, right?
I watched Days of Future Past once on a plane, and they said, you know, this. Well, I forgot what it was, but it was a different boilerplate at the beginning that I'm used to seeing. It was like, this movie has been. The format's been edited to fit your screen, and it has been edited for content. It contains a scene of airplane violence. And there's that scene where Magneto tries to pull the plane down.
Yeah.
And that scene is like really cut in the airplane version of the movie where they're like,
people get out all the
crashing stuff.
You don't want people freaking out on a plane.
You can watch Flight. And that airplane stuff really isn't edited out. And that's a hell of a lot more realistic.
I think you know what you're getting into.
You know, it's the same thing as that, but it's way worse.
Hey, can you? People are freaking out about this XLR cable that's on the couch next to you.
What's wrong with
other side? Can you just like throw it over the edge? Yeah.
Hey, everybody.
It used to be a lot smaller.
What's worse is the when you're in a car listening to the radio, and it's an advertisement or something where they play car horns or alarms or an ambulance siren.
Oh, yeah, it's the worst.
I hate that.
Yeah.
That's the worst thing in the world. Even though you know, like, almost within half a second what it is, I just want to reach through the radio and punch whoever programmed
it. The worst
sirens.
For me...
Sirens.
The worst for me is TV shows, commercials on TV where they have, like, a car alarm arming, like the chirping noise, because my dogs start growling and start barking at the door because like, they think someone's, like, parked a car and is outside, like... No, fucking stupid dogs. It's the TV. You've heard this before. Fucking idiots.
Did you ever see the airline version of Speed?
No.
Remember when the bus drops below 50? Do you remember what happens?
It explodes.
Yeah, but do you know what it hits?
Oh, no.
It crashes into a plane.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So in that version, you see it like drop below 50, and then it just cuts away to like a reflection of all the people like seeing an explosion. But you don't see it explode, or you don't see what it hits.
So it seems really unsatisfying.
Like, oh, it's like it was huge down. The whole movie's about that bus. Spoiler, by the way. 1994.
For a 20-year-old movie? 20-plus-year-old movie?
21.
No, it's probably further than that, right?
94.
Speed?
94? Yeah, 21.
Yeah, 20 years. Wow. We were talking about Sylvester Stallone the other day. You know Sylvester Stallone was born in 1946?
What?
Yeah. So Blaine was telling me, because Blaine got to go see an early screening of Star Wars today. But he was talking to us afterwards about he went and saw Creed and how much he really liked it. And I was like, you know, Rocky won Best Picture and beat out Star Wars for Best Picture. And now it's really weird that there's a Rocky movie that's very critically acclaimed.
Yeah.
The moment we have another Star Wars movie that's got probably the most hype of any Star Wars movie. This has more hype than Episode 1, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm going to go eat my Star Wars oranges and
this is the most
put
hype
my
of
Star
any
Wars
movie
cover
ever.
Girl on and go watch it and open it.
The marketing tie-ins are just, they're unbelievable.
People were mad about those oranges.
The oranges, that was hilarious.
The BB-8, the BB-8 oranges?
I couldn't be mad about it because it was so funny.
Yeah, it's a...
I mean, it's just like it's buying a billboard though, right? You're just buying the front of oranges.
I know
it's space.
We know somebody who's going to the premiere tonight. Flash is going to the premiere tonight. So once again, I'm wondering how did that happen? But
maybe him and Blaine can talk about it after.
Those are probably the only two people who can talk about it to each other in secret. So I forgot to mention I was talking about my headphones that broke earlier in the podcast. If you rewind, you can hear it again. So
put on your headphones for
when they broke. There was internet on the plane, so I took a picture and I tweeted something like, had these for 11 years. They've been great headphones, but they fucked me right at the end. And I tweeted it. I didn't tag Bose or anything. And then when I landed, I had a tweet reply to me from Bose customer support that was like, oh, really? Sorry to hear about this. Follow us so we can send you a DM and we can fix this. And I was like, no. Like, I wasn't trying to shame them. The product was great. It worked for 11 years. So
but
I just replied.
They're going
to
send you a replacement pair.
I bought another pair. I was like, big fan of the product. I already bought another pair. This isn't about that. This isn't about like trying to shake you down. It's not like some kind of sleazy customer service thing.
Good man.
Yeah.
I would have taken the free headphones.
No, I was very happy with the product.
I mean, it's always my instant reaction too. Like, I always see people on Twitter who are like clearly like angling to get stuff for free, you know? And I will do for video games. I don't even think about it. Like if someone sends me a free video game, I'm like fucking awesome. But like if people contact me to send me something for free, I'm just like nah, just you know, don't worry about it.
I just pass them on to Jack.
Yeah, Jack will take it. I'm sure. Right?
If it's free. Jack wants it.
Yeah. The but I just like it's just like I don't know. There's something about it. It's like I guess I was taught not to do that at some point. Like just ask for stuff for free.
I had a whole thing with Time Warner at my new house where they installed internet at the wrong address. I won't get into it. But I just asked Time Warner to follow me, and then I deleted the tweet and just went over DMs, and it worked out well. But I didn't want to like publicly talk crap about Time Warner. Mm-hmm. I ended up with like but, someone.
So you're just doing it here.
So you couldn't get.
I mean, it's done now.
So our houses are built by the same company same, or whatever. Same one right? Man. They're like the same. It's like the same house.
Yeah.
Like you got the duplicate house of mine.
I'm excited to come over.
Which house? Your current house?
Yeah. So like his
so
house.
The house that he has is the same as your house.
Yeah.
I okay. didn't know this.
Now I don't even right. need to go to your house.
And I used to have.
I didn't know that.
Because I saw pictures of his house from Egg. And okay. It's like, and it's the same builder. And
I
just want
to make sure
stuff.
That you had not been invited to his house yet.
Although.
Because he had a whole other house that I never went to
well,
one
to be
time.
Fair, nobody did. And also, bullshit.
Lots
USB
of people did.
Cables,
first of all, lots of people USB went to your other house. Did, and I went did. To your house. I just wasn't allowed in. I got to drive you to the front door and drop you off.
Name people who were in my house.
Michael. Jeff.
That's people. That does
Blaine
qualify people.
Was in your house?
Blaine was in my house to move a DDR machine.
I was at your house to drop your sorry ass off, and I still didn't get invited in. So go fuck yourself, asshole.
Just but anyway, port. Matt has USB ports.
Gus, did you go
plugs.
Over there? His house?
No.
Okay.
I think I knew where it was. Maybe.
I'm fine with that. That's true. I did one up you on the USB.
Mine are just regular, boring electricity.
Yeah.
You can swap that out. It takes like 2 minutes. It's so easy.
Have you sold your other house yet?
No.
Guess that your house.
I've had two houses. I have a duplicate house with Gavin.
Like I said, your now. Other house.
And my like my last houses. House was a duplicate house with Alan.
Huh.
We had the exact same house before.
It wasn't so even now, like mirror image. It was like literally exactly the same.
It was exactly the same. Exact same floor plan. Exact the builder, like exactly the same.
So was it down weird to be in his house? Was it like just slightly off from what you're
it was
used
like,
to?
Like, and it was mainly like, oh, they're way better at decorating than we are. It's like you go in his house and it's like, our house could look like this. This is way nicer. So I now like want to see how many other people at Rooster Teeth I can just have a duplicate my, house with.
I had a fun house.
I think
experience.
That'd be like the weirdest like achievement.
You're
to
gonna
unlock.
Just start building custom houses now, so it's impossible.
Oh, yeah. So one of the things we always talked about is the weird trend too, where when we hire somebody to come work at Rooster Teeth, we immediately hire somebody who has the exact same name. And yes. I'm trying to think like for instance, we just started for the first time ever. We worked with somebody named Ezra on Laser Team.
Right.
Instantly started working with someone named Ezra.
That's
at
right.
Full screen. Ezra Cooperstein. Who everybody
we had that,
loves.
We had that discussion last week.
Yeah.
And we also work with someone here who looks like Ezra.
that's true. That's a weird one too.
I think I might have the ultimate version of that. One of the teams on The Amazing Race.
Yeah.
The woman who had the viral video where she's a flight attendant and did the funny announcement. Her daughter's name? Hagen.
Really?
Spelled the exact same way. H-A-G-A-N, which is my character's name in Laser Team.
I've never heard of
I've
that
I've never
before.
Heard that name before in my life. And as soon as like I have that name in my life, then somebody else shows up that has that name.
On social media, I've seen one person who says his name is Hagen, and he's excited about Laser Team, and he wants to go watch it because he's never met anybody else named Hagen, and he's excited that there's a character on the screen with his name.
I love that new trailer. Trailer number two.
Hey,
it's class.
It's a great trailer.
I like it too. And
is that only the second trailer? It feels like the billionth trailer.
I know, it does.
Yeah.
Well, I want to say one thing about the trailer that I'm actually really proud of that you can't see in the trailer, which is we made a conscious decision to not include any of the scenes that people said were their favorite scenes from the initial screenings because you know how like people always complain like, oh, all the best parts are in the trailer. We deliberately did not include what people said are... The best scenes.
Because there's a lot of good stuff in this trailer.
There is a lot of good stuff.
Like that bit, and that bit, and that bit.
That one's...
If you're listening to the audio version, you can watch the trailer. It's the official trailer number two for Laser Team.
What's funny to me is you said that nobody's favorite scene is in the trailer. I was going to comment. There's a lot of Gus close-ups. A lot of Gus in this trailer.
People were very happy to see you.
Nobody liked that.
Well, I'm not saying there aren't good scenes. Obviously, there are good scenes, but... Just, you know, when you go see a trailer and then you see the movie, you're like, oh, they already revealed all the best scenes. The two scenes that people consistently cite as their favorite scenes in the movie, we avoided putting in just so people would feel like absolutely sure they got new stuff.
Cool. Which I've kind of turned the corner on that now. Like, well, the trailer shows everything, but it's like, it's kind of like the trailer is its own thing, and it's supposed to get you to go see the movie.
True.
Yeah, it's like one of those things where it's like, it doesn't bug me quite as much. It's just like one of those things I've learned to accept over time.
It seems like people hate either. They hate when the trailer shows too much, or they hate when the trailer doesn't show anything.
If the trailer doesn't show, like the Star Trek one is getting blasted right now.
Exactly what I'm
for not showing enough.
Right.
And it's like, well, do you want them to show the whole movie? Is that what you want?
It's fine. It's like, cool, Star Trek. You know those guys? Yeah, Enterprise. Cool. That's a movie. Go watch it. I mean, what else do you want?
That's all I want.
It's like, to me, it's like this. Like I turned off Star Wars trailer because I was like, oh, this is cool. And I'm like, if I got to the point where I'm like, okay, this is cool, I'll just go see the movie now, and I don't need to see the rest of the trailer. And it was specifically. I had seen all the Star Wars trailers, and then there was another one that came out that was the Japanese trailer, had additional footage, and I was just like, at this point, I know I'm going to see it. I know I'm excited about it. Why see anything that's going to...
That's a lot of willpower.
...screw
though.
It over. The last time I tried to do this was way back in the Matrix movies. I was like, I was going to watch anything for it, and I was going to go in fresh, which, yeah, good for me. I went in fresh to that pile of shit.
So you think that... this Star Wars sequel would be as good as the Matrix sequels?
Hey, listen,
is
dude.
Is that what we're predicting based on this pattern of behavior?
I like J.J. Abrams a lot. I think especially what he's done with like Star Trek and everything. Gus and I have watched J.J. Abrams television shows going back like almost two decades now, it feels like. But listen, I mean, I was super... You remember episode one when it came out? Everybody was super hyped.
Oh, of course.
It was going to be amazing.
Was that more hype then or now?
You know, I mean,
what was the big gap?
I think it's more now. It feels like more.
What's funny is the world is so different now. So episode one came out in '99, and at the time you couldn't buy tickets for a movie online.
Yeah.
So in order to get tickets for all of our friends, Jeff and I camped outside of a movie theater for 2 days.
Yeah.
And anyone who wanted us to get the movie tickets, they just had to bring us beer. And we were sleeping in a tent behind this fucking movie theater down in South Austin. And it was like, we literally slept outside in a tent. We convinced a theater employee to let us run an extension cord inside so we could hook up a PlayStation and play video games in a tent out behind a fucking theater. Did that. And then like went up and bought fucking tickets for Star Wars.
Honestly, I was kind of surprised when... they made such a big push for Star Wars Force Awakens to have online ticket sales, because to me, the camping out, that's something I associate with just Star Wars. Like, people don't camp out for any other movie, but they've been doing that since Empire Strikes Back. People have been camping out for days. That's where that whole like camping out to wait for something movement, I felt like it started. I'm sure people did it for concerts and stuff, but now people just fucking do it for Black Friday. I want to go by every time Black Friday is about to hit, and those people who camp out from Wednesday to save $200, I just want to go out and just like stand there with a bullhorn and berate them for like 20 or 30 minutes. Something about that just drives me fucking nuts.
Yeah, is people trying to save money? What do you mean?
No, it's people don't value their time.
Yes, it's just bad economics.
Right.
You know, it's just like...
But some people's time, you could argue, isn't as valuable as yours.
48 hours for $200.
Yeah, if your time is worth zero... then it makes sense.
And if your time is worth zero, spend the 48 hours learning something to like, you know, it's just like, and that's not why people do it. People want to be part of that spectacle, you know what I mean? And it's like, I think there's some people who go just to get invites. I really do.
Yeah, of
course. They want to push people around, and they want to be part of the mayhem, but fucking Black Friday drives me. Every time I see something to do with it, and I was not in the country, so I got to see like an outside view of it, I'm like, fucking God damn it, Black Friday, I hate it.
Did you see the clip of that woman yanking something off a child?
Yeah,
and it was like
a blender,
a $15
right?
vegetable steamer or something.
Yeah, that's
and they were all over the floor. She just took the kid's one.
Yeah, she's like turns around and yanks it away from the child.
Why did the child want a vegetable steamer?
I mean, the mother had grabbed
no
one.
Kids like vegetables.
The mom it to the like, kid to hold because they could buy two, and then she turned around to get another one. And as she was grabbing the other one, someone else came and took it from the kid.
Poor kid on so many levels.
That sucks, man. That really does suck. A kid being in a situation like that. That's like an adult pulls something away from you. That really sucks.
Yeah.
And then,
unless it's a vegetable steamer.
And then your mom starts wailing on that lady. Yeah. So it's like, it's bad all around.
Did you see that there are people camping out for Star Wars in front of Man's Chinese Theater?
No.
For this one?
Uh-uh.
It's like, there's no reason to. Right? Because you can buy tickets online.
Right. And probably tickets are already sold.
Right. But they're doing it.
Do they want the best
seat? Because they want to do it. I don't think so. I'm not sure what it is.
I don't know if it's assigned seating. Like, I don't know. It's like they got the seat with their butt groove in there. They just want to like sit in it. Maybe it's just part of that culture. Like you said, like just wanting to camp out and wait and find other people who are willing to waste their time too.
So that was good.
It was like the people at the Alamo when they were complaining about reserved seats. They just wanted to wait in a line.
That for no reason. To this day, boggles my fucking mind. What Gavin is talking about, this is a whole segment I screamed out in the podcast a few years ago, which was the people at the Alamo. It used to be Alamo Theaters here in Austin that you had to show up 2 hours before a movie, a 2 hour movie, in order to get a ticket to go to this, to go to it. Otherwise, you were either corner of the front row or you just didn't get in. Mm-hmm. You know, if you tried to show up like 30 minutes before a movie, totally unacceptable. And then they got a thing where they went online, but then they didn't give you reserved seats. You just bought seats and that was it. And you still had to show up an hour and a half early just to get a halfway decent seat, even though you had a reserved ticket. And it was like, there was talk about them getting reserved seating, like where you said, I'm going to be in this seat for a long time, and people fucking fought it. I put up a TripAdvisor.
They launched it, like, and then they review? Took it down, and then they put it back up, like, years later.
Yeah.
It was super weird.
And then they were going to do, like, Southwest style, where they, like, went in groups, you know, and there was talk about that as well, which, does anybody like Southwest's way?
I hate Southwest.
Does anybody like the way that they run their airline?
If Southwest has a direct flight somewhere, I'll happily fly a connecting flight to avoid flying Southwest. That's me not valuing my time, but also devaluing Southwest as a terrible airline.
I mean, the airline's fine, I think. I just don't like the boarding procedure. It's a way to, I mean, I know their whole thing is like no fees and low cost airline, but it's a way for them to like try to scam $25 out of you. It's like, hey, if you want, you can pay for this early check-in thing and we'll make sure you get in the A group. If not, oh well.
Or sometimes you get the kiosk and you want, it's like $130, you know, like the day of, because it's an upgrade to Business Select or whatever.
Right. Then it's like, oh, you get to be one of the first 15 on the plane.
But Southwest started from a good place, because a guy we used to work for, Gus and I, his name is Anthony, and he used to do a lot of traveling because he was in telecom sales. And he remembers when Southwest just first started. And he said it was great. He said they would take $20 in cash at the door, at the gate. Like, this is before they needed to see a boarding pass.
As a bribe?
No. That's how you got on the plane. It was almost like a bus. And it was like, there was a flight. You know, this is back in the 70s, I guess, when it first started, early 80s. And if you wanted from Dallas to Houston, you wanted to get on it, you just went to the gate and paid the person $20 and got on. And that's the way it worked. And that's why they don't have reserved seating. Because they used to do it that way.
Yeah. And then everybody got on and smoked cigarettes the entire flight, too.
Exactly right. Yeah. They got their pressurized tube and smoked.
Different era.
How come there's been, like, no thing where, like, flight attendants are all dropping dead from, like, the 70s and 60s? Because they were in those tubes filled with smoke constantly.
I don't know. It's probably just part of the larger, you know, casualty numbers from secondhand smoke and smoking.
Smoking is one of those weird things. I mean, I'm not denying the link between smoking and lung cancer, but it is one of those weird things where it's like, it's not a guarantee you're going to get lung cancer. It just really amps up your genetic chances of getting lung cancer, it seems like.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, there's some people who smoke cigars their entire life and live to be 120 with no problems, right. You know? But it's like, there's some people, it's like, I remember reading about a baseball player who developed a dipping habit for like 6 months and then quit, and 3 years later he had throat cancer. Mm. And it's just like, yikes, that sucks.
It's odds, yeah.
Yeah, just odds.
You know, down in, again, we're talking about Australia. In Australia, you know, when they sell cigarettes, they don't put the cigarette company's branding on the cigarette boxes. It's just, the box is a picture of a cancerous organ, and it says, smoking causes this. And then, like, really small fine print is, like, the brand of the cigarettes.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think that's really a much better way to do it. And the cigarettes aren't out on display. Like, if you go to the store and you want cigarettes, they're, like, in a locked cabinet without, that's just like steel, it's just metal. It's like you have to tell them specifically what you want, and they go in, they get it, and they hand
it's,
you your
cancer. It's similar in the UK. Like, to the untrained eye, it looks like you're buying a packet of smoking kills.
Yeah.
That's all it says on the packet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so why don't they serve like their greasy, crazy burgers in a wrapper that like shows the clogged artery?
Or the beer, right? Big beer culture. Yeah. Why not like a diseased liver?
Yeah. Well, I think you see more of those things too. It's like, I think that's an offshoot of having publicly funded healthcare.
Yeah.
Is because that's more of a burden on the whole system. So then it becomes more of an issue of, you know, trying to reduce that burden on everybody, right? Like, did you ever see the workplace safety ads that Canada ran a few years ago? Like, how to be safe at work and avoid accidents?
No.
They were, oh my, you never saw them?
Was that like the one where the guy's getting his hand like sucked into a machine and he can't reach the button? And
yeah.
It's like slowly pulling him in?
And it's they're gruesome. They're gruesome. The most gruesome one I remember was a cook who's carrying a like a pot of boiling water or a pot of like boiling grease or something. And she slips and spills it all over herself. And then she's like screaming on the ground on screen for like 5 seconds straight. And then it like cuts to a slight like avoid workplace accidents. It's like, holy shit. Patrick, can you find that? Because really just the imagery from that is pretty
that
shocking.
That sounds really chipper. I can't wait to see it.
It's just, it's fucking crazy. It's
yeah, England's road safety ones were pretty mental too.
I've seen some of those.
England and Ireland, like.
You worked on some of those, didn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just people, just filming people pretend to die.
Well, the funny thing about that is Gavin worked on those as a project where he would film like in slow motion, like what happens to a body when it's in a car accident. And, you know, it's they're just road safety videos. But it really affected you. Because you're very keen on road safety, like
I'm very keen on other people being strapped in with a seatbelt in a car with me.
Right, so they don't bounce around.
Yeah, because they will kill me if we crash. It's just gonna happen. Like a loose person just kills everyone else in the car almost every time. So it's not for their safety. It's like I don't want to die because your big lumpness comes and headbutts me in the face.
Oh, yeah. Uh-oh. She's like, oh, hey, I have a big plan coming up. She's talking to the camera. I have a wedding coming up, but I'm not going to get to do any of that because I'm about to have an accident
you're
in my
thinking,
workplace.
I bet
I'm
it's
not
about contact lenses or toothpaste.
She's like, oh, she slips. Oh!
Oh, my God.
She's screaming this whole time.
Oh, Jesus.
That was a television ad.
Wait, I like the YouTube title for that. Beautiful brunette, victim of gory accident. Was that the name of that video?
That was gruesome.
They're looking it up. I'm pretty sure.
I'm telling you, they were
well,
really.
Maybe she wouldn't have accidents if she weren't filming commercials at work.
And using air quotes for no reason.
Just do one thing at a time, lady. Beautiful brunette.
Can we play a quick little game? You're going to read an ad?
I'm going to read an ad.
I'm going to come back and I'm going to play a game when we get back, which right. is, I'm curious, with this group here, I'm curious, who has a Christmas tree in their house and who doesn't?
Okay. Ah, read your ad. Let me read this thing.
So you can figure that out.
Oh, I got this. Hold on. This podcast is brought to you by Sherry's Berries.
Is it?
Yeah. Every gift from them is an instant hit. Get Sherry's Berry Sweet, freshly dipped strawberries starting at just $19.99. That's a 40% savings. These gourmet berries are fresh. I'm having an off day. These gourmet berries are fresh, juicy, and dipped in dark, white, and milk chocolatey deliciousness. Then they're sprinkled with decadent toppings like chocolate chips and chopped nuts. And you can double the berries for just $10 more. Jesus, dude. To get this deal, go to berries.com and use code TEETH. There's more than just berries. They got snowman brownie pops, chocolate dip peppermint cookies, and cheesecake bites, and lots more. The only way to get this amazing offer for Sherry's Berries starting at $19.99, visit berries.com. That's berries.com. Click on the microphone in the top right corner and type TEETH. Go to berries.com, click on the microphone, type TEETH, order them today. So, everyone loves the Sherry's Berries here at the studio. Owen? Can you show that to Wait, camera?
Yeah.
We had an accident where
we
got this box in order for the ad read tonight, and the person who received it forgot to put a note on it saying, this is for a sponsored ad read, do not eat. And in like the hour they were in the fridge, they almost entirely all got eaten. So
it happens.
There's only four left for the four of us.
Oh.
So that's an important lesson for the group out in the bungalow.
Those are so good.
Yeah, they're really good.
Does Sherry's Berries, is that like, we do that certain times of years where we do that like the holidays and then Valentine's Day?
Yeah, and I think Mother's Day as well.
Yeah. I had no idea that was coming.
Yeah.
Have they been sponsoring the whole time I've been gone?
I've missed the past two, so I don't think so.
Oh, yeah?
I can check.
All right.
So you're going to play a game with us?
Just curious. Like, I was looking at you guys and I was thinking, who has a Christmas tree in their house?
Gavin, are you going to guess?
I'm going to ask you.
We have not had
Sherry's. Gavin just moved, so that would be probably not, but I don't think Meg would put up with not having a Christmas tree. Although, her family does live in Austin, so she can get that experience there. I'm going to say Gavin doesn't have a Christmas tree.
Interesting.
Gus, I'm going to say you definitely don't have a Christmas tree, and Matt definitely does. And I know the answer for me. All right. You want to do anybody else want to guess?
You definitely do. I think everyone does. I think everyone has a tree.
I might not, though. I might not.
I think you do.
I was gone for a while.
I think it's important, and okay. I think it was put up. I think all three of you do.
Okay, Gavin, do you have a Christmas tree?
It was one of the first things that went into my new house.
Is it really? Okay. Gus?
You know I do.
You do? You really do? You guys are so festive.
It's a bizarre tree, though. It's not like a traditional looking tree.
Is it real? A real tree?
I shouldn't say it's bizarre. It's a
like a Dr. Seuss
it's
tree?
It's a different tree. It's artificial, and it's white. and it's like me. It's very skinny and it's very tall.
It's an artificial white tree. Does it have the lights built into it?
Yes, but we added more.
So is it like how does that work? Does it like at the end of Christmas, does all the branches go up and then you just put it away like
put
in a bag?
In a bag. Okay. Done with it.
Yeah.
We had an artificial tree when I was a kid, so artificial trees don't freak me out.
Matt?
Matt's got to have a Christmas tree.
Artificial tree.
You have an artificial tree?
Yeah, we switched to artificial tree like, I don't know, like 5 or 6 years ago because we're never in town long enough to enjoy like a real tree.
That's a good point. Your family.
And also, like, you don't want your house to burn down.
Because
we usually leave for like 2 weeks.
Shit. I should talk about what happened.
To burn down? From the lights, you mean?
Well, if you're, you know, your tree gets
dry. Dries out. You ever seen the videos when this is another gruesome video. You ever seen what a Christmas tree catches on fire?
Yeah, it burns.
It's instantaneously. A bomb.
Beautiful brunette tree gets
gruesome accident.
By Christmas lights.
It was one of my very first slow-mo guys was actually burning a Christmas tree. Went up like a bitch.
Yep.
But if you turn the lights off, they don't catch fire. What do you mean?
Well, just, you know, there's a spark in the house or who knows what. I mean, they're just extraordinarily flammable. You leave your house for 2 weeks, who knows what could happen.
Plus, he has cats.
I love the smell, and that's what is worth it to me.
The danger is worth it for the smell? I can't stand the smell.
Really?
Oh, there we go.
Yeah, that's no joke. Look at that ceiling.
Yeah, that's just getting pounded.
Yeah, it's like a flamethrower, essentially. Yeah, that's terrifying.
It's really terrifying. Yeah. It's really, really terrifying. It's terrifying when the cats knock it over.
Artificial.
It is a really dumb tradition, though. Like, it is very wasteful of, like, trees and everything. I shouldn't say it's a dumb tradition. We all love it. We all do it.
You just said it was wasteful. You didn't say it was dumb.
It's part of Christmas. I did say it was a dumb tradition. Okay. But it's I love it. But it's like, I do, every time I go pick it up, I'm like, man, we cut down a lot of trees to do this every single year.
What kind
of,
you have a tree preference?
No, I don't know them that well. Like, I'm weird. I didn't know until I was, like, 15 or 16 that there are multiple kinds of apples. Like, I just thought a red delicious apple was the only kind of apple. Mm-hmm. And then people were like I think actually it might have been when I went to college and met you.
The red delicious part was redundant. Like, there was no reason to name it red delicious.
It could have
just been called apple.
Right. Right. What do you mean?
Why call it red delicious apple?
Well, they got to come
up with only one.
If there was only one, it would just be called apple.
It's like banana.
No. I didn't know it was called a red delicious apple. I just thought those were apples. Like, we only had one kind of apple. I knew about green apples. I knew about that. But
I'd seen them in magazines.
Yeah, I heard about them.
They have those for movie stars.
Those are the ones that rich people get.
But doesn't that totally cancel out your original thought? Like, you knew they existed.
There's a billion apples. So now it's like...
There's no reason to have all of those. We just need Honeycrisp.
That red delicious apple...
Every other apple can go fuck itself.
No, only apple that I knew about.
Honeycrisp is probably the best.
Honeycrisp is easily the best.
But I don't have Pink Lady up there.
Macintosh is good. I think that... What's the one that's the bottom right? Like, one from the far bottom right?
Paula Red?
Yeah, that one's good.
I like there's one just called Jonathan.
That is kind of weird.
He turned into an apple.
Yeah. That's pretty bizarre.
Yeah, but I didn't know that. And it's like, I think the first apple I tried that wasn't a red delicious apple was a Fuji apple. And I thought it was like some kind of...
You know they grow them on Mount Fuji?
Is that true? No, I don't know. I don't know. My apple
Can
knowledge...
You grow apples on a mountain?
My apple knowledge... Well, they could be grown near in the Fuji region.
They probably are.
Yeah.
I'm going to look where... You're going to be observing yourself.
I read a story...
Where do they grow the Jonathans?
I read a story a couple weeks ago about this ad agency in Tokyo where they've had this tradition for decades where whenever they have a new hire or whenever someone gets promoted to senior management, they have to go and climb Mount Fuji.
What? Where's this?
It's some ad agency in Tokyo. So all new hires and anyone who gets promoted to senior management has to go climb Mount Fuji.
That's cool.
I guess they've been doing it for, I think it was for something like 70 years or something. And I just thought it was an interesting company tradition.
What if you're in a wheelchair?
I don't know.
Don't get a job there.
Yeah. If someone else read the story, if you could send it to me with the hashtag RT podcast.
Well, I don't know. They're definitely Japanese, but I don't know if they've grown anywhere near Mount Fuji. So.
The Granny Smith is the winner of apples.
That's the green one, isn't it?
Yeah.
You like that?
Yeah, I love it.
Too tart for me. I'm with these guys. The Honeycrisp is a wonderful.
Do you have Bramley apples here?
I've never had
one. Can we see the chart again? Do we still have the chart?
Bramley is usually a cooking apple.
You know, there's also heirloom apples. Like, there are heirloom tomatoes.
Yeah.
that like they're not, you know, they don't try to keep them within one genetic line.
Do we have it?
Like those, they're just like
this is
you know.
This is one picture of apples. That's all it is.
We're using this as like
these are all apples.
There's no grapple up there. Do you know what a grapple is?
Yes, it's a grapple.
It's grapple. Is that how you say?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Grapple. Wait, wait.
I tried one for the first time the other day.
And?
Bullshit.
No?
It's awful.
Really?
And I discovered something else about it. It's an apple that tastes like a grape.
It's grape flavored apples.
It's so I thought that the way they accomplished this was some kind of crossbreeding. Like, have you ever had the cotton candy grapes?
What?
No.
They're grapes that have been genetically bred.
Yeah.
And selected, so they taste like cotton candy when you eat them.
What?
But so I thought the grapeple was the same thing, where it's like they've been bred, so they taste like grapes. Nope, they've just been soaked in some shitty, sugary grape juice.
But cotton candy isn't like a genetic flavor. I mean, it's like somebody made up sometime. It's like
right, but they select
it's like Mountain Dew flavor.
It's like combining
grapes.
Yeah, combining steak with the DNA of pizza.
They didn't take cotton candy DNA. Here, there's a picture. They just selected grapes that tasted more and more like cotton candy, and then bred those together.
There's sugar. that's what cotton candy tastes like, right?
You gotta admit, cotton candy doesn't taste like taking a spoonful out of a bag of sugar.
But it is just sugar.
It kind of does.
But it doesn't taste just like eating imperial sugar.
No, I get what you're saying. You're right, but why is that? There's no flavor they add to cotton candy. It's just sugar. Mm. So does cotton...
Well, what's caramel? That's just sugar.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Just bubbled up sugar.
Yeah. Or it's cooked, you know, down a little bit. I guess cotton candy's kind of... What is cotton candy? It's like air whipped? I mean, I don't know how else to describe it. It's like spun.
It's just so light that it all fluffs up.
Candy floss.
Candy floss.
For those of you listening from the UK.
Was it fairy floss?
Fairy floss. Is that what it is?
Candy floss.
Candy floss. What's fairy floss?
Uh-oh.
Is that the Australian one?
Maybe it's the Australian version.
Cotton candy, the grapery. Yeah, I see it right here.
Those are okay. They're too sweet, though.
Oh, well, because they taste like cotton candy.
Because they taste like
sugar. You know
sugar.
What you're signing up for when you get a cotton candy flavored grape?
Yeah.
It's going to be a little sweeter.
The grapeples, like I said, it's just like grape juice or like some artificial flavor. Like, it doesn't taste natural, and they're mealy as fuck.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Nothing worse than a mealy apple.
That's the worst.
I agree with that.
Yeah, it's just, it's not good.
Soaked in.
And they're expensive. It's just a fucking ripoff.
That's one of the secret immersions.
Yeah, fuck those guys. That's them right there.
You remember the immersion we did with the fruit flavorings?
Yeah.
Or the artificial flavorings?
I had worked here long enough. I didn't eat any of that stuff.
No, I don't blame you.
I looked at it. I was like, "No, this is a fucking trick." There's just food out here.
It was not video game related, so I think that we did that one. Was that one sponsors only? I think.
Well, yeah, we should have at PAX.
Oh yeah, maybe it was an event only one because it was like one of the immersions. Sometimes we shoot immersions and they don't work. In fact, I had, right before I left for 30 days, we shot an immersion that kind of didn't work. What happened with that, Gav? Are we trying to make that work? Was that ever edited?
Yeah, they're cutting it into maybe like a. Here's one that didn't work kind of
right.
episode. Or maybe we'll revisit it and like stick that at the beginning.
Yeah, we that one got that sometimes with immersion it gets
it didn't work, but the good thing it was super expensive.
I know. Listen,
so it's got
it,
that going
it
for
was
it.
The expense that made it not work, actually.
Yeah.
Because we had too many cooks working on something. And it was like, you know, there was people who there that were like taking they were talking about all the shit we never deal with, like safety precautions. And that really kind of like that really did actually throw us off a little bit. Like, we had professional people who we're making sure that we stayed safe, and then just made it kind of not fun, you know? Or they were okay with, they're used to working in an environment where everyone is safe, and then you just fake it and make it look like it worked, but the show, you don't fake it and
we
make
it
look
like
it
worked.
We want
it to be as real as possible. So we could have achieved it, but it would have just been a setup.
It would have been a stunt.
It's not really
it would just been a stunt, basically, is what it was turning into. So that was the kind of thing. We talked about it on the podcast right before I left, and I said a thing, too, where I said, one of my favorite immersions of all time was the one we're putting out next. But communicating with a large group of people is really difficult. We'll talk about this with the laser team screenings in just one second. But it's like when I made that statement of like saying, we shot an immersion, we have one in the can that's about to come out, and then we did one that didn't work out so well. But this one didn't work out so well. But the one we're putting out next is going to be fantastic. Well, when I said that, they thought that I meant the one we're putting out after the one that didn't work. Not the next one we're putting out,
right.
Which is was the Five Nights at Freddy's one. I was super excited about the Five Nights. Everybody loved that one. That was a fucking blast.
I'm glad you explained to me what their thought process was, because I didn't understand how they thought it was the one after Five Nights.
Yeah, that's because I said, because I was talking about, we have three done, The third one is we don't think it's going to work, but the one we're putting out next is great.
Okay.
Is like, or the one that's next is great, is what I said. So some people who heard me talking about the third one then saying the word next,
okay,
thought I was talking about the fourth one, which we are shooting more immersions, but we had to wait until I got back to start working on. We have some really great concepts, which is what drives that show. So, and the Five Nights at Freddy ones, I thought you guys just killed it.
It was really good.
Yeah.
It looked great.
It was all down to the crew, like making it so realistic.
Yep.
It was entirely real.
And that was... every bit of that was live. Yeah. I think we showed that the behind the scenes.
In the behind the scenes, that's explained. I love how all the comments talk about how, oh, they were just looking at static video feeds. You know, nobody was actually moving around. And then in the behind the scenes, they show everything was moving.
We were also controlling the light in the video, which proved that it was live.
Mm-hmm.
When we press the button.
They don't know that. Yeah. Thing is just
we could cut
edited.
To...
Oh, I guess, yeah.
The button, when you press the button, you can cut to a thing with the light on. You know, listen, when we were working out the algorithm for how that episode was going to work, I suggested many times that we just have canned footage, you know, and just like cut to that. But they really wanted to do it live. And there were so many. I have a picture of it. I'll send to Patrick. But there was so many cameras around here. There was like probably like 3 miles of cable through this place to connect all those cameras. It was crazy. That was Daniel Fabello and Marcus Laporte, who really did a lot of work on that. I mean, everybody worked really hard on it, but those two in particular. Daniel directed the episode, and Marcus is our production designer.
Daniel also cut the Laser Team trailer.
He did. He really did. He did a great job. We had the first one was done by a major production trailer house, and I think Daniel's is like, it's great.
You know?
I mean, it has the benefit of having the audience having seen it a couple times now, like in select screenings, and so seeing what people react to.
Because the first one we made, the movie wasn't finished.
That's right.
And we didn't have any visual effects done, and it was it was really early in the editing. You know, there was stuff in the trailer that didn't even make it into the movie because we didn't know where it was just what they call an assembly cut at that point, which was just, it was, you know, basically everything without taking a scalpel to it and really making the scenes tight.
One of Matt's, you talk about stuff that's expensive, one of the most expensive scenes got cut. Not the most expensive, but for what it was.
One of the scenes that I was like, I really wanted to keep the scene. I thought it was going to be so cool. And it is. It's a really cool scene.
It'll be on the deleted scenes.
Yeah. You'll see it on deleted scenes. It's a really fun scene. And it had an old friend of ours in the scene.
Oh, it did. Yeah. Yeah. David.
David Blackwell. And so.
You know David Blackwell? Little Austin joke there for
you. What is that? What is the name of the lawyer?
Betty Blackwell.
There's a lawyer in Austin who has commercials where it's like some lady's on the phone. It's even like the way she reads the line is terrible. She's like, I just don't know. He's in jail and I don't know what's gonna happen with him. Oh, you do know Betty Blackwell? It's like, I don't even know why she reads it that way. It's just anyway, but
I think Patrick's the only person who laughed.
It's a very famous local commercial in Austin. Such a terrible line. Oh, you do know Betty Blackwell? It's like, what would the other person say on the other line that would cause that reaction?
He found it.
We can't play the audio, but...
What's up with the frame rate today?
Yeah, it's jittery. Do you know Betty Blackwell? Beautiful brunette Betty Blackwell.
There's Betty Blackwell. I wonder if Betty Blackwell is still practicing.
Yeah, she is. They updated this commercial recently. So it got cut, but it'll end up, that scene will end up in deleted scenes.
We have some pretty awesome deleted scenes from the movie, so I'm kind of excited about that. But we should tell people about the
screenings.
The screenings.
So one of the, what you're talking about, communicate with a large group of people, is that we have a release for Laser Team. I'm explaining this as best I can, Matt, and you stop me if I'm explaining it incorrectly.
I don't think
We have a theatrical release for Laser Team, which will be in the US for select cities, like a normal release for a movie of this size for theatrical screenings, and that's great, but we recognize this is a global audience that watches this, and there's a lot of people who don't live near a selected city, so we went out and formed a partnership with a company called Tug, where you can essentially say, I want a screening in my town. Doesn't matter where it is. Lansing, Michigan, Houston, Texas, wherever you want. And there's even some international support for, you know, UK.
We're trying to add more.
We're trying to add more all the time. New Zealand and Australia also have it as well.
Yep.
And what you can do is you can go say, hey, I want a screening in my town. You set up a screening. It lets people know that the screening exists. They can go look it up. And then once they fill a certain number of seats, they say, okay, now this screening is guaranteed.
Right.
So, and it's working great. I think, I don't even know. I can't
keep up with the list of cities. Go to LaserTeamTheMovie.com if you want to see it.
All right. So update on this. So we we launched this basically on Friday, and we told our Indiegogo backers about it first, and then we kind of like just started rolling it out to everybody, and it sold, everything sold out by Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
So, which was an awkward day for it to sell out because, you know, you can't really like get more theaters and get stuff moving again because it's the weekend and those people who do that stuff aren't working. So today we were able to upgrade a bunch of the theaters. Like a lot of the theaters that sold out were like, you know, 150 person kind of theater venues. Those got upgraded to 300 or 350 person screening. So if you tried earlier and it was sold out in your area, try again. It's probably available now. And then we also have been able to add more screenings in Australia for sure. I think maybe the UK also, we added more screenings.
I saw loads on the map on Australia. There's even one in Tasmania if you want to go to
yeah,
that one.
Yeah, we were able to get them pretty much everywhere, yeah. And then we're still trying to add Ireland. There's been a ton of requests for Ireland. We're still trying to get those added.
Also, I found out that Northern Central Ireland Europe is not part of the UK, according to Tug. I mean, it is, Northern Ireland is part of the UK, but like it says Tug's available in the UK, but not in Northern Ireland.
I think it's just how their network
works.
It's more about the commercial aspect than the governmental lines.
No, I get it. Yeah. That is the problem. It's hard to communicate to people, is that a lot of times the rules around international distribution have very little to do with the people who make the content and more so to do with your country. Like if something's blocked in your country, like you see something's geo-blocked, you're like, they don't want to let us watch this in Germany.
Yeah.
You know, they don't want to let us watch this television show. What's wrong with them? It's like, no, there's a company in Germany that paid a lot of money to distribute it in your country, and they're the ones that are making the requirement that they block it. I'm sure major television networks would love to sell the rights to other countries and then still make it worldwide available online. You know, that would be fine with them.
There's also, I mean, there's other stuff too that like not even we really have full insight into, like the Canadian screenings that we're having. The pre-sale for them starts like in a couple days. What's today?
Today's the 16th? The 14th.
14th. So theirs starts in a few days. And everybody else's has already started, and even though the theaters are picked up, I can't tell you why. I just don't know.
I'll tell you why.
It's a conversion.
That is because we don't like Canadians. That's why. I'm sure that's what people tell us. That's why it is. No, but it's been great watching the list of cities come in. It's like I can't wait to see like the full list of all the different cities where we're going to be showing Laser Team. It's going to be awesome.
And then the other thing that's cool with Tug that we didn't really cover is like you can make your own screening, right?
So
you can request it. So we have a bunch that we set up in advance, figuring that these will hopefully cover big areas for us that where a lot of people are, then hoping that people, if we didn't cover that area, that they would set up their own screening.
A lot of people have.
They got 1,500 requests.
Jeez.
Yep.
For to host your own screening. So they're trying to parse those down and make sure there aren't too many overlaps.
Like you don't want one in East Houston and Northeast Houston.
Like, you know, 10 people requested the same theater or something like that, trying to consolidate those. But those are supposed to start going up on Thursday.
Yeah, like, for example, a super saturated, super wide release movie would be like 3,000 screens.
Correct, yeah.
So yeah, 1,500 that's a lot.
That's a ton.
That's all. Yeah. That's like...
Like 3,000 screens is like a summer blockbuster release.
Right, it's exactly. Like 1,500 would be like half of
what Avengers. Is that still the number, 3,000? Like what is Avengers release on?
The Avengers probably released like 4, yeah, somewhere in that range.
But I mean, three is huge. That is a huge number.
That's a huge release. And it makes it a little bit easier. Can you imagine how difficult this would be if we still worked in a thing where we had to make prints for all these cities? It wouldn't happen.
It's insane.
We'd be doing that right now.
No, it'd just be too expensive. we wouldn't be able to do it. But
so what do we do, just email it?
Basically, we just it's an attachment. Everybody's gonna get around a laptop and watch it, and they'll be like, "Move the mouse, get it off."
There's no physical thing anymore.
There are these physical like cartridges.
Oh, okay.
And I don't know why they use them because it seems like you could, but I think that's like a safety, like a security thing. Like they don't want to zap it over the internet.
That makes sense.
But in reading all the feedback, it's like I'm really super excited to see all the list of cities, but it's like it's so hard too because it seems like, I don't know, every 10th response, you know, maybe a little bit less, is someone going, "Oh, it's not playing in my town. I guess you guys just don't care about Idaho." It's like, no.
Just go request it.
You can absolutely request a screening. That's really frustrating because it's like, I keep like, Maxie Matt on Twitter too. It's like, we're constantly like re-messaging and you just got to like, that's just what you have to do with big groups of people. You have to constantly say the same thing again and again and again.
Right.
And it's like, for people who watch all the time, they're like, "God, they won't stop talking about this." But it's like, there's always going to be somebody who still doesn't understand.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I read one comment earlier today where somebody was just really mad saying, you guys aren't listening. They said just make your own screening. And they were like, really like got angry about it. And I mean, I get how that is, but it's like, you just have to say the message over and over again.
You do.
And it's not, you know, and everybody does that where you just like, you only hear it one time, you know, or it passes by, you're thinking about other stuff.
Yeah.
But when you're talking to, you know, 10 million people, you have to repeat that message so often because so many people within that 10 million person group are going to miss it.
Right.
The people who are paying attention feels like you've told them 10 million times.
I looked it up.
Definitely hard balance.
Age of Ultron opened at 4,200 screens.
4,200.
Wow. So yeah, that's that's a crazy number to me.
Yeah. And it's like that.
But I'm excited. You know, I mean, when I was like scanning through the list of theaters and all the theaters, like the venues being filled up, I was thinking about when we showed it in Toronto. Actually, we did the screenings at the Toronto After Dark Film Fest, and that was an amazing venue. Such a great theater. It was like a 500 seat theater, and we did two screenings, and they were both sold out. And something about seeing it with a ton of people, you know, is just so much fun and so exciting. And I think the screenings on the 27th and 28th are going to be awesome because it's going to be, you know, the community together and, you know, 300 people in a room, 400 people in a room, just having a great time. I'm excited about that aspect. And, like,
We were talking about how everything's about community, and the community made the movie possible. To have like all these like community events everywhere with people watching it, it's just like, it's so
pretty cool.
Cool.
I want to see people lined up for it.
What's that?
Camped out, waiting.
There was our fans are great about that. I mean, it's, when I went to RT Ireland, I was like walking up to the event. It was just like, it was a line of people around the block. And we were all in like this one little bar. I was like, all these people are going to get in there? That's fucking crazy.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, when Achievement Hunter went to New York recently, the only place we could think of having our meetup was just in the middle of Central Park because any location would have just got flooded with people. And I think 150 people showed up.
Yep. It's nuts.
That was like less than a day's notice.
Hey, so are you guys, I heard that you guys were going to go to Taiwan. Are you not going to Taiwan now?
I think that trip's not happening. Oh, really?
You should go. I heard you're not going because you don't have time to go?
Yeah, you should go. It's busy time for Achievement Hunter.
Taiwan, though. How busy can it be? Just play Fallout. Like, make a bunch of Fallout videos.
They have internet on planes now.
You guys playing Fallout?
Yeah.
Yeah? What do you think, guys?
Let me read this and I'll talk
about
that.
You have your door problem yet?
Door problem?
Like where you can't go through doors like you could in New Vegas?
Oh, no, I've not had that problem.
Yeah.
Let me read this. I want to remind everyone, this episode of the podcast is also brought to you by Squarespace. Start building your website today at squarespace.com. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase, go to squarespace.com/roosterteeth. Squarespace, build it beautiful. With Squarespace, your site will look professionally designed regardless of skill level, no coding required. They have intuitive, easy-to-use tools. Squarespace has state-of-the-art technology, powering your site to ensure security and stability. Trusted by millions of people and some of the most respected brands in the world, Squarespace starts at just $8 a month. You get a free domain if you sign up for a year. Start your free trial site today with no credit card required at squarespace.com. When you decide to sign up for Squarespace, make sure to visit squarespace.com/roosterteeth for a free trial and get 10% off your first purchase. Squarespace, build it beautiful. Right there, squarespace.com/roosterteeth. Someone in the control room before the show was talking to me about Squarespace before the show started. Was talking about how they couldn't believe how easy to use it was and how intuitive. So if you want to build a website,
my kids use it.
Really?
Yep.
Yeah, totally believe it.
What are
they
doing?
They're making websites for fun.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
Like, yep. I mean, going back to like this Tug thing, sometimes I feel really fortunate about, you know, things that exist when we like you hit the right point at the right time, like things like Indiegogo, things like Tug.
Yeah.
Things like Squarespace would have been great when we were starting.
Oh, I can't even imagine.
We have an appreciation for it because some of these tools that exist today, we just didn't have.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was trying to explain that to some of the other racers on The Amazing Race. It's like, well, there was no YouTube when we started. I'm just talking with them and they're like, so where did you put the video? It's like, we would put it on a computer and at a hosting facility, a co-location facility, and we'd host the file ourselves. And they're like, what does that mean?
Yeah.
It's like just what to explain that. It's just a computer.
Imagine if you had to build YouTube.
Yeah.
That's pretty much it. You built your own YouTube.
We had to encode our videos ourselves, you know, for different versions, for different resolutions for people and stuff like that. It's so funny. Like, it's just like things can become so advanced that you just don't understand, like the bones behind it. You know what I mean? You don't understand.
I mean, people will complain they upload a video and it's like, man, it's been processing for like 2 hours. It sucks. And then you think, what's it doing? It's making all these different versions of your video and making them play on all these different browsers. And all you did is press one button.
And it'll publish it when you're done. It'll just publish it.
Yeah.
And it'll publish it, like, if it gets some of them done, it'll put those out and then it'll add the other ones in later.
I was convinced, like, when computers first started becoming really popular and the internet first started becoming really popular.
When computers became popular. That's the oldest thing you've ever said.
Back in my day, I was convinced that this was the early, mid-90s. I was convinced in the future, everyone would totally understand how computers work and totally understand everything about the internet. And this, because that's what you had to know. You had to know everything about your computer. You had to know everything about connecting to the internet. And I thought, yeah, in the future, everyone's going to know about how all of this stuff works so that when it breaks, they can fix it on their own. And now it's just become a black box.
It's basically the opposite.
Yeah, it's exactly the opposite.
Yeah,
nobody
cars.
Has anything at all.
Nobody has
Everybody
any
drives
idea.
A car. Nobody could maintain a car.
Well, that's going to get even worse then, I guess, when we really do, everybody has self-driving car.
Yeah.
So you think when cars first came out, everyone
fixed
them?
Oh, you had to use a steering wheel?
Yeah, I mean, because early adopters were like huge enthusiasts, right?
Right, yeah. That's, well, I've never thought of that analogy.
A lot of car companies will just block users from messing with the engine.
That's true.
Like, the guy I used to work for, his BMW, he opened it up once, and it was just like a big black lid over the whole thing that you needed like a special key to get into. It's like, I guess they don't want you messing with the engine.
Right. That's how they can do
it. Didn't Joel buy a BMW one time that had the governor removed or something?
Oh, the limiter was taken off.
Yeah.
I hate that.
The thing was crazy.
I hate that when cars have like a rental car, when you rent it, and then it you drive 60 miles an hour, and you go a little bit over, and it starts dinging at you. Mm-hmm. You ever had that?
Uh-uh.
All you do is try to find out, how do I get rid of this sound? Yeah. Let me get rid of this thing.
It's annoying. No. It's annoying as fuck.
You played a lot of Fallout 4?
Dude, I've played a lot of Fallout 4.
I realized I was really enjoying that game. Loving it. I'm not going to spoil anything. But the moment you have to start making decisions on who you're going to side with, I instantly liked the game less. Because I was convinced I was just making the wrong decisions.
It is true.
I was like, should I be making a save here? Should I be saving here? And then something else would happen. It's like, now I'm going to have to decide on this or this. I'm going to make another save just so I can come back and do the other. Because I want to have the best experience. And the fact that all of a sudden I'm playing along quests that are causing me to not have other quests bugs me.
Yeah. And I'm one of those people, it's like, as soon as I get a quest, I try to finish it. And then, there's this dude that you meet early on who just, throws you quests.
I avoid that guy. If I see him in the distance, I run away.
Yeah, if you get within earshot of him, he'll just start talking and it'll give you a quest.
I wish there was an indicator for quests that are just ongoing.
Some quests,
they'll be like, go and get this thing from here. You'll give it back to them and they'll be like, all right, now go and get this thing from here. It just goes on forever. It's just never ending.
I'm with that robots are having me do that right now.
But I don't realize until three quests in, I'm just like, oh, I'm just a wild goose chase. I'm just not going anywhere.
It's always achievements in games where it's like, oh, I want to get all the achievements in the game. And it's like, oh, complete the game, get this, play a couple multiplayer matches or whatever, do this, then collect all these things. And you're like, okay, that's great. And there's always that one achievement that's get an 8x combo in this. And you're like, oh, 8x combo, that sounds fine. And it turns out it's just the hardest thing in the world to do in that game. That takes about 75% of your total time of getting all the achievements. Is this one little thing, which when you read the description for the achievement, sounds totally innocuous, but it's like, collect all the trophies. And it's like, there's 8,000 trophies, but you don't realize that when you start the process.
Yeah.
So, but I've been loving Fallout 4. This is potentially, I'm not very far into it. I'm maybe a third of the way through the game. This is potentially a little spoilery, but I'm going to avoid doing it. So just be warned if you're not playing Fallout 4 yet. There's a person that you're trying to find in this, and then you find the person and they're a little bit different than what you expect. Mm-hmm. That seems like that was a non-moment in the game. That would have been a way bigger moment to me, but there was no reaction to that at all.
What do you mean?
Well, I just didn't. I saw no reaction to that.
I got to that bit and I was like, "Huh?"
Yeah, but the character's not.
Oh, you're not.
Yeah, the character has no reaction to that whatsoever. I mean, I definitely had a reaction to it, and I totally understood why it was different.
I got to that bit and I could not believe that had not been spoiled for me.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Did you see Game of Thrones season 6 coming back in April?
Is it?
Yeah.
That's soon.
They released an image.
Isn't it April?
Sometimes it's March, I think. And plus, there was some question the way that the HBO lineup worked this year that it might get pushed a little later. So I guess just confirmed April.
That'll be right about the time The Amazing Race is wrapping up.
Oh, so yeah. We'll be able to transition from one.
Are you gonna have Amazing Race night at your house?
Yeah.
How many episodes is Amazing Race?
It's 12 total, I believe. Yeah.
Wow.
12 total.
Do you think you're in any of them?
We got eliminated in the first one, so after that, I don't give a shit after that, so.
Hey, Gus.
What?
I have a question.
Hit me.
Why have you been tweeting at me so much?
Have I been?
Yeah.
Oh, I have, yeah.
Why? It's weird. It's creepy. It's creeping me out.
Really? What's he tweeting you about?
I'll tweet and he'll reply.
Probably because you invite him over to your house. That's why.
We hang out in secret.
He feels comfortable.
When I was on the road, I was mobile a lot. Like, I wasn't at my computer. Okay. So I was like, I spent a lot of time on trains or on planes just checking Twitter. So it's like, that's all I could do is like just
trains?
Reply to
people.
What
are you doing on
trains? When I was in Sydney to get around the city.
Oh, okay.
We spent a lot of time on the train. And amazingly, cell phones work great. It was even when you're on the train in Sydney. So, because lots of times you go underground and cell phones cut out, but it always worked the whole time.
Twitter definitely takes an uptick for me whenever I'm traveling.
Yeah, and like, people started asking me, like, why is Gus tweeting so much? Like, what's going on? It's like, I was just on the road. I went, speaking of Sydney, RTX Australia happening in January. If you don't have tickets, fuck you. It's too late. it's going to be amazing. We went and we toured the 2016 venue, which is the Australia Technology Park, and it's probably the coolest venue I've ever seen for an event. They call it the Australia Technology Park, but I think it was built in the late 1800s when trains were technology. So it's got like very a steampunk feel and aesthetic to it. And it's a historical building. They've got like a blacksmith workshop in one area and like this locomotive repair yard.
BioShock area over there.
It's really, really an awesome venue. Super cool. Mm. But I went to what is now my favorite bar in the world while I was in Sydney.
The Manor Bar?
No. It was, that's in Melbourne, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah.
It's closed.
This was, the place was called Baxter's Inn. And specifically, I think the place was called Baxter's Basement. So we heard about this from someone that I did an interview with. I did a bunch of press while I was down there. Like, you got to go check out Baxter's Basement. Like, okay. So,
in Sydney?
Yeah.
I may have been there.
Yeah, we
go. Is it down an alley in the...
I'll get there.
Okay.
So they give me the address. I'm like, all right. So I get an Uber. I'm like, I'm going to this street. And Uber drops me off, and like everything on the street is turned off. It's like nighttime, and there's no lights on. I'm like, well, I don't know where this bar is. And I'm walking. I'm like, there's nothing here. And there's an alley, like you said. And you walk down the alley, and the alley forks. It's like a T intersection. Mm-hmm. You can turn left, you can turn right. And I was like, well, I see some people to the left, so I walked over there. And I was like, is this, you know, Baxter's Basement? I'm looking for the Baxter's Inn. And this guy with the thickest French accent in the world is like, no, this is the barber shop. I was like, oh, okay. So like, I turn around and walk out. I'm like, well, I'll walk down the other side of the alley, and there's nothing there. There's just a door. And you open that door, and then there's like some stairs that go down. You walk down the stairs, and there's a sign that's like, please be respectful of our neighbors and make no noise after 10 p.m. Like, all right. So I try that door, and you open it, and it's like this basement bar that has the best, coolest selection of whiskey I've ever seen in the world. They have like this... Oh, that's it. How did you find?
Yeah.
Wow. They have that board there in the middle with all the different liquors they have and the different prices. And they have whiskeys I've heard of, but I've never seen before.
Who took you there?
Like I said, I was heard about it from someone I didn't interview with. And like whiskeys that I've wanted to try and I've never seen anywhere. And I ordered one. And so that you saw the big setup they have with all the different drinks. They have a separate safe with all of the different, like all of the really high-end whiskeys.
So you're telling me there's more than one kind of whiskey?
Yes.
I thought it was just Red Delicious whiskey.
Fuji also.
They go and they open up the safe and they bring the stuff out. So I got...
the Grisky. A grape-flavored whiskey is the best.
I tried the Pappy Van Winkle, which was fucking amazing. But they had, I forget what it was. I think it was Dalmore Constellation. It was Scotch. And if you ordered it, it was $740.
For what?
For a glass?
For what?
For one pour.
For what?
Is that a shot, basically?
Yeah. $740.
Holy cow.
I did not drink that.
$740?
The Pepe Van Winkle I had was $80 for the drink.
Now, that is the kind of thing, like, Gus...
That Alan would
Gus
order?
Gus doesn't have, like, a thing. Like, Gus is, like... You don't spend money on, like, any particular thing. Like, some guys are, like, car people. You know, some... You're not even... I don't really think of you as being a gadget guy. Mm. I buy a lot of stupid gadget stuff. But... Occasionally, you will do like high end stuff. Like, that's what you'll do. Like, that's the kind of thing if, like, you had spent $750 on a glass of whiskey, that's the kind of thing I could see.
Well,
you
also,
doing.
You're buying the experience there, too, aren't you?
Like, you bought the Lemur Poop coffee.
Oh, yeah, that was great.
Yeah.
Civet
coffee. And that's like $80 a pound.
Oh, it's more than that.
Yeah. Well, it was like $80 for like a little
thing.
Yeah,
it's like $300 a pound.
By the way, totally worth the hype.
So good.
Yeah. Totally worth the hype.
But I really thought about trying that. That $740 drink, I just could not bring myself to pay that. I was like, there's no way. I'm not drunk enough. And then when you're drunk, you don't appreciate it. So
yeah, like that's the only time I've ever had Johnny Walker Blue is at a bar because I think it's like
what is Johnny Walker Blue? It's like $100 a shot or something.
It's like $400 a bottle. Yeah. But it's like a like so you can get a glass of it for like $40.
So you just
went
to sip those whiskeys? Like if you added Coke to them, would they be like
Yeah, they probably would not be happy about that. So when I ordered the Pappy Van Winkle, the bartender was like he's like very, very happy.
He gave you a Pappy Van Wink.
Yeah.
You
do you remember when we were water as well, debuting season two of Red vs. Blue back in 2004, like January of 2004? And we went to New York for the Lincoln Center.
Mm-hmm.
When Graham put us in the Lincoln Center to show it. And Gavin, you were there for that, right?
I was there for the 2005 one.
Okay. And we went to that. Remember we went to that hotel bar? I believe it was the Hudson in Manhattan.
I do remember that.
And we got drinks and they were $25 each. And we were all mortified.
I remember I ordered that drink and I had pulled out a 20 to pay for it. I ordered like a vodka tonic and they handed me like $25. I was like, oh, like I had to reach back into my wallet to get more money.
The Sex in the City.
Yeah, was it? That was it. It was like all underlit. Like the lighting came from the floor.
Yeah.
It's not a flattering angle to be lit.
No, it was horrible. It was like
neck. And
the lighting was all green.
Yeah, it was something, And like
that was the whole place was weird.
There was like a down tree in the middle of it, if I recall correctly.
It was so bizarre.
But it was I remember thinking $25 for a drink, that's literally insane. I was just like I couldn't believe that. And it's like since then it's like I think I've paid $25 for drinks at other places since then, you know, and it's just like
it's
now
still
it
not
seems
like a common thing.
No, man, no, not for us.
And it was
like
it was well drinks, right? For $25 bucks. It wasn't
perfect price of a drink. $8.
$8? Yeah. No, like $3 for a drink.
$3 for like a Jack and Coke for $3?
Did you drink a lot at the party?
I think I had 4. I'm at, like ever since I moved out from Jeff's, giant lightweight now. Like
oh
drunk
my God,
after,
I'm
like,
such a lightweight
a drink
too.
And a half, I'm done.
It's great though, isn't it?
It's cheap, yeah.
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 But I always, you know, I always know when it's like, this is when I stop drinking.
I hadn't had much to drink all last week and then at the party, I didn't have a lot. At the
Did you hit it hard?
Not really, no. I mean, it's like I didn't have that much, but I, the next day, I couldn't really remember what had happened, and I felt had that kind of sickening feeling.
I
like
hate that.
I must have said something wrong.
Yeah.
Do you remember what you said to me in that alley?
Are you being serious right now? Were we in an alley together?
You're giving me old Pappy Van Wink.
I guess so.
At least it wasn't on charity live
stream. I gave him a Red Delicious.
So you went on Good Game when you were down in the pocket, right?
Yeah. It was awesome.
Yeah, that's a Good Game is a really great show.
Those guys. You know, I think that they had a very streamlined production. They had really good questions. It was fun to talk to them afterwards. We just hung out for a bit, like just shooting the shit. We went. Yeah, did Good Game. We did CNET.
And Hex is going to be the keynote speaker
for Hex is going to be speaking.
RTX Australia. So that'll be awesome.
I lied earlier. There are still some Sunday passes. So if you want to go on Sunday, we'll still be there and we'll be having fun.
Was that the shortest period of time you've ever been in Australia?
Yeah. It was less than 5 days, like 4.5.
Are you guys going to be there for a little bit during this? Because Laser Team's coming out. So it's kind of like during RTX Australia. So it's like there and back really quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's gonna be interesting. We're doing the Australian premiere there as well on Friday night, which is the 22nd.
I can't wait to get on this plane, like 14 hours. I mean, actually, not gonna be like it's like nothing. You know what I mean? It's like
you'll be out of practice by then.
No, I don't know, man. It was like it was pretty serious. I just wish that one of the rules with the race is you can't. I think it's okay to talk about this. You can't use any of your existing perks for an advantage. So you can't get the miles for your flight because you can't like
really
tell anybody your frequent flyer number.
Well, that's awful. What a waste.
It's a reason not to do it right there.
Some people I think are like we're saving up their information so that afterwards they can do it. You know what I mean? But if there was anything that would give you an advantage, like you could get early boarding or preferential seating.
If you're platinum, you just had to board with everyone else.
Yeah.
The plebs.
Or talk your way into it, which you can do. So.
Yeah?
Yeah, you learn a lot. I learned a lot about traveling.
Throw them a wink.
On a budget.
Get on first.
That's a pain in the ass. You have to go back and try to retroactively claim your miles because lots of times they'll ask for like the ticket number.
The ticket number.
So it's like you have to save all of your stubs.
That's not on any of the emails. That's on the actual piece of cardboard that you got.
Yeah.
That's probably why they do it. You make it hard. I hate that when I go to a kiosk and they ask like, I have 50,000 numbers on a piece of paper and the one they want is the one I don't have.
Right.
Like, we need your confirmation code. And it's like, well, I have a reservation number and I have a ticket number. and I have a flight number, but I don't have a confirmation code.
We don't know what any of that is.
Yeah.
It's like there's only so many people on the plane. Yeah. With this information, you can figure it out, right?
It's like, how many people on the plane have my last name? What are the chances? There's maybe 150, 200 people on this plane. But no, it's like, we need all this specific information. They make it more difficult than they need to, for sure.
All right. Well, it's about time to...
It's about time for you.
...to wrap up. So I want to thank everyone for joining us and listening to us ramble on for this period of time. We'll see you guys next week.
And don't forget, if you want to make a screening for Laser Team in your town, just go to laserteamthemovie.com.
Yes.
And you can set up a screening.
Or see one that's already set up. You can do that too.
Or make one that's really remote, so it's funny.
Like Juneau. Antarctica.
Thanks, guys.
Bye, everybody.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Rooster Teeth Podcast. We got Gus.
Gavin.
Vibra.
This is Bernie.
And Gus.
What if a radioactive man bit a spider?
And Gus.
You need a therapist, dude. You really need a therapist.
That's what I want.
Let's go back to our original conversation. If a spider stood up with three or four legs, would four of its eyes disappear?
It's a room you can go to that is soundproof and is isolated. It's like in the middle of a building if you just want to get away from the noise and the crowd of the city. It's a small room with a chair.